are so delighted to have with us tonight the chairman of the board, Joe Seiler, and Ken Henderson, the executive director of REAF. And I know you don't know what REAF is, so we're going to have them tell us. And welcome. So happy to have you, Joe.
Well, thank
and
you.
Ken. Thank you so much. And REAF, help is on the way. What does REAF stand for?
REAF stands for the Richmond Ermitt AIDS Foundation. It was founded by two moms, Barbara Richmond and Peggy Ermitt, who both lost their only sons to AIDS as a way to honor their sons' memories and to raise funds for the kind of agencies that took care of their sons before they died.
And this is going on for 10 years now.
This is our 18th year.
Oh, my
God. Yeah. Yeah. One of our shows is 10 years. But
oh, Help is on the Way? Was that the one?
The holiday show is 10 years. Okay. But we started, it's actually going on the 18th year for our main gala, Help is on the Way, the main gala that's done in the summer.
And the story behind this, let's go back on the two mothers were friends from childhood.
Yeah.
And then they got together when they were 70 to live together because their husbands passed away. Mm-hmm. And then one of the sons died first of AIDS. Mm-hmm. And then 4 years later, the other son died. And tell us the whole story behind how it all started. It started from that nucleus.
Mm-hmm. Well, the two moms, native San Franciscans, their families were here for many years, grew up together. They were friends, both kind of lived their lives, kind of went separate ways for a while. Barbara Richmond ended up divorcing her husband, and Peggy Ermitt lost her husband. And they sort of reconnected back here in San Francisco and decided to become roommates. And about the same time.
At the age of 70.
Yeah. It was amazing.
That's a story alone.
Yeah, it's amazing.
But, well, they both needed support. They didn't have husbands anymore. And they had been friends for all of their lives and just enjoyed each other's companies. And Barbara made a comment one time I found really funny. People always wondered about them, two little old ladies kind of living together. And she said, well, some people probably think we're lesbians, but I guess we're really just domestic partners.
Yeah. And then you were friends with one of the sons.
Was our best friend, yeah.
And when he passed away, they approached you.
Yeah, they approached us to see if we
just
would help.
Just because you're friends.
Yeah, they would
not
say,
that
can
you've
we
been
help
in the
out?
Field.
And we would like to do another benefit, because they did a benefit when John Richmond, Barbara's son, passed away in 1990. And they said, well, can you help out and do a benefit? And we want to keep this going. So they asked us to do it, and we said, well, okay, but we really didn't know what we were doing. But we got all our friends together, and we said...
We started in the garage.
No, we didn't start in the garage. We actually started in the living room.
Okay.
But we did get everybody together, and we said we want to put on a show, but we wanted to do it as a quality entertainment event, and we wanted to spend no money because we wanted all the money to go to the charities. So we got them in the middle, all in a circle, and we said, you're in charge of the auction, and we need help here and here. And everybody just kind of came together.
And Ken's in charge of 20 things.
Yes,
and you're in charge of the other 20.
I do the kind of show part and that sort of thing.
And the others are in charge of 60%.
Yeah, and some of them, it's been 18 years. We still have Gary, who's still in charge of the silent auction. It's raised hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars.
Oh, that's wonderful.
And, and many, many, many people have helped out over the years. So it eventually, it grew. And that first event, again, we didn't know too much of what we were doing, but bottom line, it built. And we had the Phantom of the Opera stars and the ballet and the symphony, and everybody came together. It was a sold-out event at the Palace of Fine Arts.
And since, Russell. And
yeah, and for the years.
Right.
And it ended up being now the largest show in Northern California for AIDS, and was as a big gala, especially our in the summer. And after that, we've expanded to other programs. So we have year-long entertainment events, and all the funds go to the local AIDS charities.
The problem we have with that sometimes is people think the Broadway cast are just going to do like a concert version of their show. But it's entirely different. They put together entirely new material, and it's an original show all the way through. Mm-hmm. They're always phenomenal. Every cast has their own feel. We've worked with Phantom of the Opera. It'll be a little more classic. We've worked with the cast of Hair. It's a little more down home and funky, but they're all amazing shows.
And let's talk more about AIDS and the services that are helping people with AIDS. Mm-hmm.
It's really kind of frightening what's going on right now because funding has been cut so much government funding. You know, the whole economy is still recovering, and it's a really slow process. But government funding for aid services has been cut dramatically. The Ryan White Care Funds, which are one of the primary government sources for funding, been redirected so that, I guess in an effort to be fair, the government was trying to redistribute funding so that not all the big cities was getting all the funding, although most of the people with AIDS are within the big cities. So it's been really dramatic for a lot of agencies. Several agencies have closed in the last couple of years that provided vital services. They've tried to redistribute their services to other agencies, but it's really tough. The good news about AIDS is that it's a misperception. A lot of people think, I have drugs now that control it, it's a manageable disease, I don't have to really worry about it. But the truth is, not everybody can handle the drugs, number one, but there are more people living with AIDS and depending on the services that these agencies provide to keep them alive and keep them healthy. And that's what we're trying to do now. Where when we started this organization, it was really about helping people die with dignity, because AIDS really was kind of a death sentence at that point. But it's not now, and it's really about helping people live with dignity, to give them hope and give them access to the kind of services that are available if we can continue to fund them.
And what we've been doing is doing the shows, which also create awareness about the need. And that's the whole part of it. We entertain people, but we also let them know the need is still there. We touch them during the shows, and we bring people together to be able to volunteer and to be able to give back and keep it out into the public's eye, because it, people are starting to forget. And what we've been able to do is to, so far, donate over $2.5 million to over 30 Bay Area agencies. And there have been several cases where agencies have said, I just received the check, and thank God we've received the check, because we were teetering on going under, and we kind of helped them in order to be able to get through difficult periods. And it's all through volunteers. I mean, everyone, you know, we have so many volunteers that are part of it, and all the performers donate their time. But our challenge is always getting sponsorship and, you know, and you know, advertising and all those types of things, and doing everything on a very low, you know, on a shoestring. But it is a, there are major galas, so no one knows what's going on behind the scenes.
So was it Barbara or Peggy when she was in the hospital with her son and she saw that there was no family for some of the members in the hospital who were dying of AIDS?
Barbara. It was Barbara.
Barbara.
And she's adamant. She was just adamant that I will support my child. That was her whole thing, and she wanted to bring the message. And the first event that we ever did was the day after Mother's Day. It was the two mothers, and there were some of the performers. I remember Lisa Broman from Phantom of the Opera. Her mother came on and played piano for her. And it was just many things that were tied into mothers accepting their children. And that still does happen today.
That you the know, mothers don't.
In the, you know, or overall,
families,
to some degree.
Yeah.
But
but
years ago, when it was first started, there were many people that were just left and abandoned by their family when they found out that they were HIV positive or that they were AIDS.
Yeah.
And Barbara just stood up and said, I will not have that happen. So bottom line, that's what was started out of sort of the love of two mothers and their friends and making that whole thing happen. So Help Is On The Way had become kind of a, it's a whole family process. And we've had so many people, and we invite so many people to be a part of it, to help out, and you know, with resources and those sort of things, because we're constantly looking for new resources, auction items, people to volunteer, all those types of things. And we're in San Francisco, but we also help the entire Bay Area.
This is
That's something that a good point to make, because the name Richmond Herman AIDS Foundation, so many people think we're based in Richmond or in the Richmond district.
Right.
So we're always trying to explain to people.
It's the last names of the moms.
Right.
Yeah. Yes. And Help Is On The Way. Why did you come up with that name?
Well, that was really interesting, because there's a song called Help Is On The Way. And the song was recorded by a very close friend of ours, Nancy Lamott, who was a fabulous singer. David Friedman out of New York wrote the song, and he wrote it for Nancy, who was out doing AIDS benefits. And we knew Nancy very well. She did it in New York, and then she asked us, we asked her, could we utilize that as the theme for our events because it was so wonderful. And she came and sang it in our first event. And unfortunately, Nancy passed away 6 months after of cancer. It's like a whole web, the whole organization of people who have given back and been a part of it. So we've been so fortunate.
It's a wonderful spider's web.
It has been.
Yeah.
Ask people to be a part of it because it.
Well, this show is helping.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
helping bringing in.
Yes.
Yeah. Help is on the way, hopefully, from our viewers too. And you have some Dancing from the Heart coming up.
Yeah, one of our other events is our newest event is called Dances from the Heart. It's Bay Area dancers united in the fight against AIDS.
And some of the dancers are from which companies?
Company C Contemporary Ballet, who was on our Christmas show that we had not long ago. And we've got
Samoan
Ballet. It's bringing together dancers from many of the top ballet and modern dance companies.
This is also the first time that the companies are all coming together for AIDS, and we're very excited about it because it's just like with Help Is On The Way, all of the singers in Broadway, that whole world coming together. Now what we're attempting to do is to bring the whole dance community together in the fight also, because they're very willing to do it, and this is the first time that we've attempted to organize it. So we're very excited about that, and that's going to be another program. So we do the Dances from the Heart, plus Help Is On The Way, Help Is On The Way for the Holidays, and the one night only cabaret nights and receptions for our donors and all those types of things.
So our viewers will be so happy to go to this party cabaret event, and I'm sure our viewers will be happy to help in any way that they can help, and we'll be leaving your website information if they want to know any more information. And thank you so much for coming.
Oh, thank you,
Joe,
so much.
Joe and Ken, thanks. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you.
So I did go to Help Is On The Way cabaret fundraiser, and it was so delightful. And one of the dancers, Oliver Friesen from Company C Ballet, was performing. And I have kidnapped him tonight to perform for us live. So sit back and watch this wonderful performance of Oliver Friesen. And the fundraising for REAF brings a whole community of people together and companies together. And we've brought also the Company C Ballet that also helps in fundraising with their performances. And tonight, we're so lucky to have Charles Anderson, the director and choreographer of Company C Ballet, which is a Bay Area dance company. And come sit and watch an intro about this wonderful company, and then we'll be interviewing Charles Anderson.
If you can force your heart, your nerve, your sinew to serve you long after they are gone, so hold on when there is nothing left within you, except the will with which to them says, hold on. That says it. That's this piece, and that's dance. And you know what? The last part of it is something that's important too, because when you're dancing for a short time, you can forget life. So the last part of that poem goes, if you can fill the unforgiving minute with 60 seconds of distance run, yours is the world and all that's in it. And what's more, you'll be a man, my son. So when you're doing this, this is that point where you need to fill that unforgiving minute with 60 seconds of distance run. And you have to force your heart, your nerve, your sinew to serve you long after they are gone. So hold on. Because we need to know who you are. If you're not showing who you are, you're not dancing. That's what the public is looking for, life. You are breathing life into them. It has to be a little bit more raw, a little bit more full. You need to create your own story. You need to imbue it with something. So you've got to reach with the body. Reach like you're pulling out of something. So we really believe there's an intention. There's something that's driving you over there. Not just that, well, there's the step, you know? But that was so much better because I felt something. You know what I mean? If you don't move us, nobody cares. You guys are being nice. Don't be nice, right? Be men. Right?
And though the holes were rather small, they had to count them all. Now they know how many holes it takes to fill the hole.
Charles Anderson, thank you so
Stephanie,
much.
Nice to be here.
So you are a dancer from New York City Ballet.
I was a dancer with New York City Ballet.
No, you're always a dancer.
Am I always a dancer?
When you're a dancer, you're always a dancer. When you're an actor, you're always an actor.
Well, I feel dancer-ish.
You are a dancer.
Yeah.
You might not be dancing and performing right now, but you are a dancer.
I just don't want people to look at me and go, if that's who's dancing in the company, I'm not sure I want to go, you know?
Right. But you have the intelligence and creativity of choreography because of your background. And
yes,
that's what I'm trying to say here.
Yeah.
And you've worked with Brezhnikov?
I have worked with Brezhnikov, but that wouldn't be, let's say, the main body of my career. But in fact, Brezhnikov started a school. He wanted it to sort of be like the way they did in Russia. So he started a school when he was running American Ballet Theater that he chose 6 boys and 6 girls to
and
come.
And you were how old?
I was about 16. And they offered to pay me a stipend to leave high school, and I was more than happy to, because...
Even if they didn't pay you.
Right, but it was a really great school. There was, like I said, 6 boys, 6 girls, some of the major names in the dance world teaching class, and we taught we took like 5 classes a day. So, you know, we had everything from ballet class to mime to anything that had to do with, you know, modern class, jazz class, everything. And it was a great learning year.
You also went to high school performing arts.
I went to high school performing arts. I studied at the School of American Ballet, American Ballet Theater School, the Joffrey School, San Francisco Ballet School. Most of your major institutions of dance at some point.
Now, dance is in your blood.
Yeah.
Because your parents were dancers.
My mother and father were principal dancers with the San Francisco Ballet. In fact, my father was the first cavalier in the first televised Nutcracker in, I think, circa 1960 with Cynthia Gregory, who, of course, went on to become a major star. So they were the first Sugar Plum and Cavalier that was on television. And then my parents went on to join American Ballet Theater.
Was that on Ed Sullivan?
No, it was like CBS. And I've got to find the tape somewhere. I know it's somewhere in the family archives, you know. And I remember it was very early on in the filming of dance, and so I remember that, like, my father's doing Alice on turns, and they're zooming in on his face, and I'm like,
"There's
it's
a sweat.
It's the leg and the turn and the, you know." But they're like,
"And how old were you at that time?"
I wasn't born yet.
But you remember seeing that.
Well, somewhere along the lines, right. My parents did Broadway and were in American Ballet Theater, and my father danced with everybody from Alvin Ailey for about 15 minutes to, you know, Elliot Feld, and so my whole family's been very involved. In fact, when Michael Smuin came and co-directed it at San Francisco Ballet, he asked my parents, or my stepfather, because my parents got divorced, and so it's a long story, but people know my stepfather as well, who ran the San Francisco Ballet School, was the director
and
of the
And his
San,
name?
Richard Kamick. And my mom was one of the leading teachers there, and so, you know, there's not a time in my life before.
Did you always know you wanted to be a dancer?
No, but I think the thing is, it changes for at least it did for me. When I was little, I think the thing was I wanted to be a nutcracker because it looked like fun. My mom said you have to take.
But unusual for a boy. I mean, boys really tend to go.
Well, I didn't think of it as ballet. I thought of it as I wanted to be up on that stage.
Okay.
But she said, "Well, you're going to have to take ballet." I was like, "Okay." And I think, you know, as time goes by, different people have different things. Like for me, at a certain point, I realized that the numbers were in my favor as far as dating at that time. There's like, you know, 70 girls and me. So that worked. And then later on, I got into it because, you know, I wanted to leave high school, and they asked me to leave high school. Later on, I started making some good money. And then when I got a little bit older, I actually learned to appreciate art and all these wonderful things that I had been surrounded by that didn't even know that I had been surrounded by many special people and had been surrounded by many special events and you know, great music.
So how did you know you wanted to be a choreographer?
Well, I didn't, but I had a father who was a freelance choreographer after he quit dancing. And I got into it in a way. My father had taken a job in South Carolina with a company there. And then he got another job choreographing somewhere else. And he called me up and he said, and I was with the New York City Ballet at the time where most of my career was. And he said, do you want to choreograph a work? Because I've got 2 gigs. I've got to do something. And I said, yeah, I'll do it. And I went down there and
for a small stipend.
Right, yeah. I went down there and I really had a great time, and I really was like, oh, this is why people do this. It's really wonderful to be this creative, and so then I was hooked, and you know.
And then a director. I mean, that's huge. Choreographer and director.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, you do a great job. I saw your company perform, and it's wonderful. I watched you in rehearsal, and I watched you in the performance, and I see how you put everything together so beautifully, from the lighting and the PR people, and you've got a great company.
This is our 10th year. I'm really happy, and luckily, you know, our 10th anniversary came in our 10th year, because in my 8th year, I would never have been able to do it. But it's taken 10 years. It was funny when you said that you had captured one of the dancers, because in the beginning I felt like, you know, I wasn't so much as hiring dancers as taking prisoners, you know, hostages.
Did they know
you're
that?
Going to dance. No, but, you know, and then now we've got this great company, and you know, it just takes perseverance and it takes dedication, and I think it takes lots of passion, and I think...
And talent. Yeah, I mean, if you're a lousy choreographer, you know, all the tenacity would not help.
Yeah, yeah.
But you happen to be very good.
Yeah. Well, I'm lucky.
And you
to
use
have
other choreographers too.
Yeah. Well, you know, I'm interested in my work, but I've also always been interested in other works, and I have, I guess, I have a short attention span because I like a lot of things, you know. So I looked at when I moved back to San Francisco, having lived in New York for many years. I looked and said, there's a niche here for someone who can curate a really great evening of dance. And there were so many works by friends of mine and choreographers that I had worked with that were of high stature and whatnot. And I knew I could bring them here and I could put that together. Because there's a lot of great companies, but there was a real emphasis on companies that had a singular focus, like Lines being about Alonzo King's work and Smuin being about Smuin's work. And I just looked at it as San Francisco is a really fantastic company, but not everything falls within their purview. And there is many fantastic things out there to bring here. And so we've had success in doing that and had success in sort of showing a much broader version of what dance can be. You know, I want to separate the idea of stuffy from ballet. It's not, but people can think that way. People sometimes will think that there's some story that they're missing, or they'll feel funny about going to an abstract ballet, and I'm like, my mission here is to let you know that there's not like this hidden secret going on, and you know, if you can balance your art and your entertainment, you know, you can have a really great evening. And I think it's also important just on a broader sense, because you know, this is where imagination starts coming in, and imagination is where, you know, human beings start bringing our better self forward. You know, and so that's why I think that sort of non-linear thought, and not necessarily being pop art, you know, but bringing art that's going to last through the years and bring our imaginations out, and I think when I talk about it, sometimes my favorite quote is Albert Einstein, when he goes, "Imagination is more important than knowledge, because knowledge only tells us the things we know." So, you know, imagination is the lines in between the book. You know.
And this is a great way to wrap it up.
Okay,
because
we'll
have to. But Einstein and Charles Anderson, thank you so much.
Yes.
Love it. Thank you so much for joining us on the Stephanie Herman Show. And help is on the way because of you. And thank you so much for helping us. See you real soon now. Bye-bye.